Chapter 14, The Empty Hole. It was a fine walk upon the ridge where we found ourselves. The pines grew wide apart, and there were large patches of sunlight between them. We grew nearer and nearer to Spyglass Hill. There were several tall trees in it. The first of the trees was the wrong one. The second was wrong, too. The third rose up nearly 200 feet into the air. It had a trunk as big as a house and a wide shadow in which of us could have fit. Into which all of us could have fit. The pirates' eyes burned in their heads as they approached the tree where the treasure would be. Silver hobbled on his crutch and cursed like a madman when the fly settled on his shiny hot face. He took no pains to hide his thoughts. They were on his face for me to read, as I would read a book. With the nearness of the treasure, all his promises were forgotten. He was thinking that he could get the treasure and escape. He would cut every honest throat and then sail away with the riches. His promise to me and the doctor's warnings were things of the past. "It'll not be beaten by man or devil," cried Silver. If there's treasure here, I aim to lay my hands on it." Suddenly, not 10 yards farther, we all stopped. A low cry was heard. Silver, who could not go as fast as the other men, doubled his pace. He dug away with the bottom of his crutch. The next moment, we had joined the others. We saw a huge hole. It had been made some time ago, for I saw the side I had fallen in, and grass was growing on the bottom. There was a broken pick and several boards of broken packing cases. On one of these boards, I saw the name Walrus. It had been branded into the wood with a hot iron. That was the name of Flynn's ship. The treasure had been here, but now it was gone. Someone had found it before us. Each of us six men looked as if he had been struck. But with Silver, the blow seemed to pass instantly. He kept calm and changed his plans in a split second. He looked at me wisely. "Jim," he whispered, "take this and stand by it for trouble." He passed me a pistol. At the same time, he began moving in. In a few steps, he put the hole between us and the others. I couldn't help saying aloud, "So you've changed sides again." There was no time for him to answer. The pirates' loud cries began to leap into the hole. They dug with their fingers, throwing the boards aside. Morgan found a piece of gold. 2 pounds, he cried to Silver. "That's your treasure, is it?" He passed it around to the others. "Dig away, boys. You might find more," said Silver, laughing. "Mates, do you hear that? That man there knew it all along," cried an angry pirate. "Is this all we're going to get for everything we've done, been through?" cried another. They were all against Silver. They clawed the earth, pulling themselves out of the pit. They got out on the opposite side to where Silver and I were standing. Well, we stood there, 2 on one side, 5 on the other side. Silver never moved the whole time. He watched them, standing upright upon his crutch. He looked as cool as I had ever seen him. He was brave, make no mistake. No sooner had I taken a breath than a volley of shots rang out. 2 of the pirates fell dead. I turned and there was Dr. Lisey with Ben Gunn. The rest of the pirates took their heels and ran. "Forward," cried the doctor. "Double quick, my lads. We must head him off the boats." At that moment, we were joined by Faithful Gray. We all set off at a great pace. We plunged through bushes that were sometimes as high as my chest. Silver was with us and kept up as well as he could. As it was, he was already 30 yards behind us when we reached the edge of the slope. "Doctor," he called to us, "there's no hurry." And indeed, there wasn't. We could see the pirates running away from us and from the boats as well. So we four sat down to breathe. Long John, wiping his face, slowly caught up with us. "Thanks, kindly doctor," said Silver. "Sitting down, you came in the nick of time for me and Hawkins here." Looking at Ben Gunn, he said, "So it's you, Ben Gunn. You're the nice one, to be sure." How do you do? Murmured Ben. He was ringing like an eel. How do you do, Mr. Silver? As we walked slowly down the hill to where the boats were, Ben Gunn told us his story. In it, he was the hero from beginning to end. Ben had wandered the island, had come upon the treasure, and had dug it up. It was his broken pick that lay out at the bottom of the hole. Then he had carried it back to his cave. It had taken him many trips back and forth until all of it was safely stored away. The doctor had learned all of this from Ben. That is why he'd given us the useless treasure map to Silver. Dr. Livesey explained to me that they had moved from the stockade to the hills in order to be clear of the sickness and malaria that lay in the swampy lowlands. Ben Gunn had had been sent out that morning to help me. I learned when he'd seen the pirates, he had swung that sea song to frighten them. All my questions were now answered. By the time all the stories had been told and all the explanations were made, we were rested enough to continue on our journey to the boats. We finally got to the beach. There we found two boats that had brought us to the island. The doctor smashed one of them so that the pirates could not use it. We all got into the other boat and set out for the North Inlet. Soon we passed around the southeast corner of the island. 3 miles farther, just inside the mouth of the North Inlet, we saw the Hispaniola. The tide had lifted her, and she moved about freely by herself. We were lucky that there had not been too much wind, or she may have drifted way out to sea, and we would never have seen her again. Gray returned the Hispaniola to stand watch. We went to Ben Gunn's cave, where he had stored the treasure. There, to my amazement, I saw great heaps of coins and stacks of gold. I had never seen so much wealth in all of my life. It shone in that corner of his cave like a blinding light. This was Flynn's treasure that he had come so far to find.